Buenos días y buenas tardes para todos aquí desde Jerusalén. Mi nombre es Jorge Diener, director ejecutivo de ADAS Internacional, y es un gusto para mí dar comienzo a nuestra primera actividad de la red de salud de médica y de hospitales de ADASA en América Latina, con un primer evento de una calidad extraordinaria que va a permitir generar oportunidades de conocer más de cerca el trabajo de investigación médica que se realiza en el Hospital ADASA desde la perspectiva no solamente de lo que se hace en el Hospital ADASA, sino de lo que se está haciendo en este momento en el mundo con las tendencias más importantes de los ensayos clínicos y las investigaciones médicas de punta que se realizarán en los próximos años en el mundo. Armar una red de salud como la que estamos armando en América Latina es un símbolo de lo que el mundo necesita en este momento para poder encontrar soluciones a una de las crisis sanitarias más extraordinarias que ha vivido la humanidad. Y tenemos la posibilidad, gracias a la tecnología, gracias al espíritu de colaboración que todos transmitimos desde ADASA en Jerusalén, con todos nuestros amigos en América Latina que fomentaron y crearon esta red de salud que finalmente lo que va a hacer es compartir, generar soluciones para América Latina y desde América Latina junto con Israel para el mundo. Ahora sí, para poder empezar este evento de altísima calidad, tengo el gusto, el honor, el privilegio de presentar al primer panelista de este ciclo de actividades que vamos a realizar, que es el profesor Eyal Mishani, un querido amigo mío, pero más importante que eso es una personalidad que vive el día a día dirigiendo toda la investigación médica y el desarrollo que se realiza en el Hospital ADASA. Estamos hablando de 700 médicos investigadores trabajando día a día para encontrar soluciones desde la clínica hacia el laboratorio y de ahí a los pacientes, estén donde estén en el mundo. El profesor Eyal Mishani, quien en su mente genera soluciones junto con sus equipos y las crea y trabaja en cooperación con todo el mundo. Profesor Eyal Mishani, están aquí representantes de la salud, profesionales de la salud de 15 países de América Latina, desde el sur hasta el norte, desde Argentina hasta México, participando en este evento, que esperamos que sea realmente de muchísima utilidad para el avance de la medicina en nuestro continente.
Thank you very much, Jorge, for the introduction and actually the description of what we are going to do in the next 30 minutes. And what I would like to do is to share with you actually the activity or the research activity, clinical research activity at ADASA, what we are doing in the field of basic research, clinical research, applicative research. And I would like to start with several slides to describe to you the reason or the motivation of conducting research in a hospital. So why do we want to do research in a hospital? First, I think it can bring to the hospital, to the patient of the hospital, cure for rare disease. We can position our physician in the forefront of medicine. It's also a good income when you are conducting clinical trials with the industry. It's international recognition, as you may know. And it's bringing, I think this is the most important, it's bringing the treatment of tomorrow to the patient of today. So what does it need to conduct research in ADASA? We believe that you need several factors in order to conduct a good research. First, you need to have a history and strategy, clinical activities, involvement in clinical trials, a clinical mass, critical mass of outstanding researcher, infrastructure, of course, and you need to work on a preclinical and clinical activity. And what I would like to do in the next 30 minutes is go over these topics very quickly and try to convince you that indeed in ADASA we have the background or we have the powerhouse to conduct clinical research. And then I think most importantly is to look into the future and to try to see what would be the main activity, the medical research activity in the future in the next 4 or 5 years. So let's start with history and strategy. You may know that the mission statement of ADASA, as you can see it here, is to strive for excellence, but the excellence also in research, by which the frontiers of medicine are advanced and humankind can benefit. So we have the strategy that was written, I think, more than 100 years ago, and we follow that strategy. And our vision is to extend the boundaries of discovery, transform healthcare, and advance medical education to deliver the promise of medicine. And we believe that in order to do so, you need to combine clinical activities, education, and research, and by that, you may reach excellence in medical activities. A little bit about the history of ADASA. ADASA was established in 1912 by Henrietta Soltz, which came to Israel and established the first, I would say, clinic by several nurses, two nurses that come to Israel. And then a few years later, a team of doctors and nurses reopened the Rothschild Hospital in the city center of Jerusalem. In 1939, it was the opening of Mount Scopus Hospital with 300 beds. 48, we abandoned, unfortunately, the Scopus Mountain Campus. 1961, we established the main campus, the big campus at Ein Karem Hospital in the south side of Jerusalem with the 450 beds. And then 1975, we came back to Mount Scopus. And today, I think that 2013 was a very important point in the time scale that we opened the Sarah Watson Davidson inpatient tower in Ein Karem campus. And a few years ago, we opened also the heart center. So this is a short description of the history of ADASA. And I would like to go over the clinical activities and education. We are running together with the Hebrew University, the Faculty of Medicine, the Faculty of Dentistry, the School of Nursing, School of Military Medicine, and also the School of Public Health. We have 45 operating room, 1,300 beds, 900 physicians. Most of them are researchers also. And we have an annual budget of approximately 500 to 600 million dollars. We are treating more than 1 million patients per year, and we have more than 13,000 births per year, and the occupancy is over 100%. We have the infrastructure to conduct clinical and clinical research. We have state-of-the-art MRI, two digital PET-CTs in the nuclear medicine department, new operation rooms and hybrid operation rooms. We have linear accelerator, several linear accelerator, and here you can see me more than 20 years ago when I was young and I looked not so bad, not as today. When I installed the first baby cyclotron to produce radioactive drugs in Israel, in ADASA. We have a GMP laboratories and of course robotics. So the first topic, I would like to discuss a little bit about clinical trials or clinical research. And It started with the ethical committee. We believe that it's extremely important to have a strong ethical committee with many members, and that this committee will have a meeting twice a month, because if you want to gain a lot of clinical trials, you need to approve or not approve the applications, and you need to work with the companies, with the industry very fast. So there are two parameters which are extremely important. One is to have a very strong ethical committee that will go over the applications and decide which application will be approved and which what. And this should be in a matter of days, or maximum 1 week, or 10 days. And the second thing is how you recruit the patient. And we have a mechanism that was developed in ADASA to recruit the patient as fast as possible. So as an outcome, as you can see, we have more than 500 submission or 500 project, new project each year, which are submitted to the Helsinki committee. We have approximately 320 studies initiated by researchers per year, meaning by our researchers. So it's not sponsored by the industry. And we have 220 industries and 220 clinical trials, which are sponsored by the industry. And you can see here the graph, how we grow throughout the years. And now we are kind of a steady state since 2014, 2015, approximately 500 new studies per year, including studies with the industry. And you can see here the distribution. And this, I think, gives the impression of what are the topics which are the most interesting topics in medicine to conduct, either basic research or clinical research. So of course, it's oncology. By the way, I believe that it will be changed in 2 years from now. And I believe that one topic that will emerge is emerging disease, to see how we can fight all kind of viruses that we will see in the next few years emerging in all over the world. But for now, it's 25% oncology, 10% hematology, 11% gynecology, and et cetera. So altogether, I think that the main field is oncology, hematology, gynecology, and pediatric, which is above 50%. By the way, this is true to clinical trials which are initiated by our researchers and also by the industry. It's parallel between the two type of clinical trials. We established a dedicated clinical trial unit. We thought that it's important enough to handle it under one roof. So we are creating the best environment for our researchers and also for the industry to start clinical trials in our hospital. And here you can see the distribution of sponsored research. Here it's a bit more oncology, as you can see here. And you can see also the companies that are conducting clinical trials in Israel. And I think that it's reflected also on the clinical trials that are conducted by Hadassah also. And you can see the leading companies for clinical trials. Again, 220 clinical trials sponsored by the industry. Another important point is that we have a special unit phase one, first in human clinical trials, which are headed by Professor Yosef Karako. And this is a huge advantage, since no other hospital have such a unit. The unit has 15 beds, and we are, by the way, it's full for the next 3 years. And we conduct all type of clinical trials, first in human phase one researchers. including we were the main site in Israel to conduct the clinical trials with the vaccine, which was developed by the biological center in Israel. And nowadays we are working on clinical trials phase 2A in this unit. So you can see that we are working with all international companies. And as I mentioned before, we are working on virology, but not only neuroscience and of course other other topics. But they choose us to conduct the first one, the first in human phase one clinical trials in the field of COVID-19, because we had a vast experience in virology and developing of vaccines in the unit in Hadassah. So this is about the clinical involvement in clinical trials. I would jump to state of the art infrastructure. As you can see, we have invested throughout the years in centers which will support our research. We have a large animal surgery room, clean rooms, HCRC, which we just discussed, the Hadassah Clinical Research Center for phase one clinical trials, the biohouse and accelerator, genomic department, and the other facilities, tissue banking, which is a national initiative where we collect all kinds of tissue from our patients, mainly in oncology, and then we can conduct all kinds of screening and experiment to develop new treatment. Recently we established, and I'm going to talk about it a bit later, we established the Translational Medicine the World Translational Medicine Research Center, which is mainly a research center which is its aim is to translate the results obtained on the bench into the clinic. So here is the World National Center. The idea is to bridge between the need of an idea that arises at the patient bed and the implementation of innovative medical care. It's a collaboration and brainstorming among scientists in the campus, but not only, also in Israel, preclinical work with advanced instrumentation and collaboration with other academic and the industrial institution. We have several advanced equipment. We have animal PET MR, 7 Tesla MR from with a bore size which fit for mainly small animals. We have photoacoustic ultrasound, optical imaging, IVIS, PET CT, and micro CT. So you can see here, for example, an image of the heart of a mice with the high resolution. We already, by the way, the center was established 2 years ago. We already have several publications, scientific publications coming out from the center, as you can see here in varieties of field, also in oncology. And let's go a little bit about the research activity. Some of them are preclinical and some of them are clinical. And let's start with one example. And I mean, as Jorge mentioned, we have more than 200 running research projects at Hadassah. I choose only several of them. Let's go to the project of Professor Inat Abramovich. And what she is doing is she's trying to do a rational drug design or rational drug screening to treat the colorectal cancer, or more specifically to inhibit liver metastasis. As you know, liver metastasis are the main cause of death, and approximately 50% of CRC patients develop metastasis, but not all of them. And the question is why? And the question is whether we can inhibit growth of metastasis of the liver in a CRC patient. And actually, this is an unmet need. And she did a literature search, and she saw that there is kind of a relationship or connection between a chronic disease or infection or inflammation in the liver and the development of metastasis in the liver. Sometimes it enhances the development of metastasis, sometimes it inhibits the development of metastasis. And what she did, she developed an animal model, mouse model, which is associated with chronic hepatic inflammation, MDR2. And she had two types of animals. By the way, to these animals, she also injected the tumor cells, and she had tumor cells, the CRC tumor cells. And she had two types of animal, a young animal, as you can see here, and old animal, 2 months and 5 months old. And when she injected and waited 2 weeks, she injected the cancer cells and she waited 2 weeks, she noticed, she discovered that in these types of animal, there is an intense growth of metastasis in the liver in the old animal, but not in the young animal. So she extracted the livers of both animals, and she tried to see what is the difference in all kind of biomarkers. And I will try to make the long story a little bit short. She realized that there are several biomarkers which are expressed in the young animal livers, but not in the old animal livers, which developed the metastasis. One of them is atropine. And what she did, she in the lab synthesized atropine, she isolated it, purified it, and then she took animals, she injected the cancer cells to the animals, and to one a group of animals, she injected saline, to the other group of animals, she injected the atropine, and she managed to show, as you can see here, that in the animals that got the treatment with the atropine, by the way, this is the sequence of the peptide, she managed to inhibit the growth of metastasis in the liver. So we are now, by the way, she has a patent, and we are trying to commercialize this finding. And she is now in a stage that she's working on conducting phase one trials in Hadassah to try to see the safety of this treatment. So this type of research project, we are supporting it. It's a preclinical research, and we have several projects in Hadassah. I would like to show you and to share with you another project which is already now in the clinical research. Is a project of Dr. Amir Heze, who is trying to treat or to try to come up with a solution for injured or degenerative cartilage or any kind of damage in the bone. And Amir developed a special protein, amelogenin protein, that may treat injured knee joint. And you can see here the image of the control and with the damage. And you can see here what is happening when he's injecting the protein. So he's trying to do the regeneration of artificial cartilage. And as you can see here in the next slide, he's making the damage, initial defect, is injecting only the media, and you can see that still you can notice the damage. And this is what happened when he injected the 0.5 microgram per microliter of his peptide. And again, he also has a patent on this project, and he's in the phase of clinical trials. You can see here in another images how he is doing with this instrumentation. He's just doing the hole in the knee of a rat, and then he's injecting the protein. So this is a kind of clinical trials that we are conducting now. I would like also to share with you some of activity in the field of nuclear medicine. We, based on our research and based on our finding, we established a spin-off company in Hadassah named Cherry, which is dealing with radiopharmaceutical research and development for theranostics, for treatment of cancer, and also for PET imaging. So this is the benefit of conducting basic research, that you can come up with a new solution, you can come up with new technology, you can establish a spin-off company, and then you can expand your ability and potential to treat your patient, and in this case, a treatment of a different type of cancer with theranostics, and of course, diagnosis of different type of patients with different type of cancers. We have a GMP radiopharmacy based on that, where we develop new radiopharmaceuticals. You can see the guys working in the GMP laboratory, working on producing the radioisotope and then incorporating the radioisotope or creating the radioactive drug to be injected into humans. We are working on different type of radiopharmaceutical, gallium PSMA for prostate cancer, gallium dotatate for neuroendocrine tumors, lutetium, different type of peptides to treat neuroendocrine tumors and also prostate cancer patients. And you can see here the list of the compound that we are producing in-house, by the way. Hadassah is supporting, or Sherry, the spin-off company of Hadassah, is supporting all hospitals in Israel with radiopharmaceuticals for PET imaging and also for theranostic. This compound is a compound which targets beta amyloid, and we started the project together with GE for the evaluation or early evaluation of Alzheimer's disease, or I would say humans which have the risk to get Alzheimer's disease, and we are starting clinical trials. We also have another investigational compound, fluorodehydrotestosterone. We found that in 50% of patients with glioblastoma, they overexpress the androgen receptor. Androgen receptor can be a good target for treatment with all kinds of androgen inhibitors. And we are trying to select the patient and follow the patient with the fluorodehydrotestosterone, which also target the androgen receptor, and we are doing it non-invasively with the PET. And maybe because we don't have all the time that is needed to describe everything, but maybe I will jump to collaboration with the industry. We have created the biohouse, and in the biohouse, it's a space for offices and also for laboratories, where we share the space with the startup company in Israel, which are conducting either digital medicine research and development. They are doing also some research and development in the field of medical instrumentation and devices. And we believe that when our physician and the startup company in Israel are working together under the same roof, it enhances the potential, it enhances the discovery, it enhances the activities, and we will be able to see in the next few years a new development that will help our patient, and everybody will benefit, the hospital and the patient. We also established the Hadassah Accelerator together with the IBM AlphaZone. And the Accelerator is an initiative to allocate something like 5 to 8 companies, startup company, which are even before the stage of starting a greenhouse. And they are sitting in our area for 6 months, and we are trying to guide them and help them to start and build a leading solution for the medical global market, mainly in the digital medicine developments. And we are helping them also with the clinical trials and et cetera. We have the business arm of Hadassah, Hadassit, which take the intellectual property, as you saw, in the case of Professor Rinat Abramovich and Professor Amir Haze. They have 250 patents. Most or some of them were already licensed to the pharma company. You can see that they are, again, working with most of the leading international companies. And there are several products which Hadassah already brought to the market. One of them is Doxil. It's a very old one. Travalen for diarrhea prevention, and also the formulation of pomegranate seed oil, which is used as neuroprotection, and some other discoveries. The latest companies are in the field of devices, guide in medical incubation device, which was FDA approved recently. Nobio is a dental restoration and protection against bacteria, which was also FDA approved, and other project. So I would jump a little bit to the future. We believe that there are several topics in the future that will take the focus of our researchers and our energy. One of them is conducting a big data research, meaning that the hospitals worldwide, they gain throughout the years a lot of data that can be used either for research in order to improve the treatment, in order to learn more about mechanism of disease and the efficiency of treatment. But the main problem is how you collect the data, how you standardize the data, how you can retrieve the data, and how can you run all kind of algorithm in order to extract from the medical data any kind of direction or any kind of ideas or any kind of results that may support your hypothesis or may support your new projects. So we invested a lot in the last 3 years in developing such a system and algorithms. We created a data lake, and we created an algorithm that will take all the data together. And we are collecting data since 1970. We have millions of data rows of patients since 1970. But we noticed that we cannot use it because it's not under standardization, and it's not collected from all kind of data house, data cares. And so that's what we did in the last 3 years. We are in a phase now of shaping the algorithm and the mechanism, the computer mechanism, and we hope that in the next 2-3 years, we will be able to use it in order to extract information that may help us develop a new treatment to our patient. Another initiative which was started actually during the corona is establishing an organoid center. Briefly, organoids are stem cell derived three-dimensional structures, which are, we are collecting the cells from a patient, and then we are growing a three-dimensional organoid that we can work on it in order to, for example, check the potential of new drugs and isolating the environment of those cells, of those organoids. We can take organoids from cancer patient, we can take organoids from the brain, from all kind of organs, and we can keep them in liquid nitrogen for decades, And when there is a new treatment coming, we can also we can always check the potential of new treatment. We can also learn a lot about mechanism of disease by using this organoid developed in the hospital. By the way, Hadassah is the first hospital to establish organoid center. We already have some prototype of organoid, mainly in CF disease. And we are going to collaborate with several basic researchers from the Hebrew University and Weizmann Institute on developing new treatment for organoids, mainly to now in CF, but also in gastric diseases. Another project looking into the future is working on application for a digital nurse. We noticed that our patients sometimes do not have the needed, connection with our nurses and physician. And sometimes they suffer at night and they cannot get answers to their needs. So we develop a digital, I know that the name, it's not, maybe we should change the name. But we develop a system, computer system, digital nurse that the patient can log in and he can retrieve information about the disease that he has. He can retrieve all the results of his test that he performed. He can ask questions about the side effect of drugs that he's using, etc. And we can follow the patient, as you can see in the next slide, we can follow the patient because he's loading the condition that he's facing on a daily basis. So we can see whether, when and why there was a change in his physical condition. We are now conducting clinical trials with the system, and we hope to come up with the conclusion or maybe with the results in the near future. So this is also something, a project which is looking into the future, into the next 4 or 5 years. So I hope that I managed to convince you that it's extremely important to conduct research, basic and clinical, in hospitals. Support the we need as a management to support our physician and researcher, to encourage them to do research and to motivate them, and then we can use the breakthrough for the benefits of our patient today. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Mishani, for this extraordinary presentation. So you mentioned, you know, at the end when you spoke about the future, you mentioned some of the directions that, you know, the future is taking in innovating on the innovation that medical research does. And one of the questions that I think that I think many health professionals are asking are related to how do you see the process or the evolution over the next few years of the timing, the time frame of clinical trials. Is there going to be any major shift in the way and the time it takes from preclinical to the market in medical research when you combine what you mentioned about organoids and other advances, you know, that that are essential for a world that is attacked by, you know, new diseases and viruses and who knows what, that demands a more speedy process of clinical trials.
So yeah, this is a good question. You know, nowadays when you come up with the hypothesis or an idea, or you understand the need near the patient bed, the time frame that it takes from taking an idea a good idea. Yeah, in most of the cases, you understand on the way that it won't take you anywhere. But in the successful cases, it takes something like 8 to 10 years to bring the drug or the treatment into market. And this is too much. Actually, this is too much. So there were several activities done in the last decade, I would say, that might help us to shorten this time. One is there is a clear regulation. So you know exactly what you need to do throughout the development process. So it helps you to come up go from one phase to the other phase quicker. This is one thing. Two, I believe that there are many instrumentation and equipment developed in the last decade, which going to help us to boost the clinical trials and also the preclinical research. And I believe that collaboration. Once we will be able to conduct collaborations between countries and to share data, it's going to foster the translation of the results into treatments and clinical treatments.
That was exactly, you know, a great bridge. Your last point with the next question we have from Azalea Espinosa, who is actually asking if you see feasible, if it's possible to work on more collaboration with the countries of Latin America.
Definitely. I think that and again, this should be done by countries and by governments, but one of the things that can be done is to decide that we are going to have an international research fund. Let's imagine that we will have bi-national grants between Argentina and Israel, or Mexico and Israel, or Brazil and Israel, or even several countries together on a specific topic. So this is one thing. The second thing that can be done is to organize, and I know, Jorge, that you are working very hard on that, is to organize international conferences between the countries, even by Zoom. I mean, you don't need to travel today to Mexico or from Mexico to Israel or from Argentina to Israel in order to share with your colleagues your thoughts and your projects and your results. You can do it exactly what we are doing now through the Zoom. So I think that I would say international conferences or binational conferences and a collaboration through a grant application or binational grant application. And I think that also kind of agreements between academic institutions, between hospitals. Let's say that there is one topic which is interesting, very interesting in a hospital in Brazil and also in Israel, and there are several leading figures in both the institution that they can conduct the research, then I believe that the institution should do everything to strengthen the collaboration between the two. And indeed we have, I mean, we have collaboration with Australia, we have collaboration with a lot of, many collaborations with the United States and Europe. So I don't see why we are not going to develop the connection and the interaction with Latin America.
Yo creo que es importante este último mensaje del profesor Mishani para todos los participantes de distintos países de América Latina que están presenciando ahora en vivo este evento y los que estén viendo posteriormente, no en directo, este evento después en nuestra versión de YouTube que estaremos circulando o por Facebook, que también esto está ahora en vivo y podrán verlo también. A través de la página de Facebook, con la página de LinkedIn, o sea, de distintas formas. Creo que hay muchas oportunidades que se abren cuando estamos creando, y este es el primer paso que damos, una red de salud de América Latina con Israel, donde el referente de Israel para la innovación en medicina es definitivamente el Hospital Hadassah. Y en este sentido creo que las oportunidades son no solamente en lo científico, sino también en la experiencia que tiene Hadassah y que lidera ya hace muchos años el profesor Mishani en lo que tiene que ver con los procesos de construcción de proyectos internacionales, de colaboraciones internacionales y poder pensar en todas las oportunidades que se pueden abrir, como lo dijo, tanto a nivel binacional, pero también como a nivel del continente. Y en ese sentido poder abrir este juego a otros actores que puedan participar en esto y eventualmente crear realmente como dijo el profesor Mishani, un fondo de investigación en medicina internacional entre América Latina y Hadassah en Israel, donde se puedan crear centros, quizás satélites inclusive, que colaboren con el Hospital Hadassah haciendo ensayos clínicos también en los distintos países y compartiendo el conocimiento. Las oportunidades son muy grandes. Quiero en estos últimos minutos agradecer a todos los participantes por participar de este primer evento. Es un evento pionero de la Red de Salud de América Latina. Y agradecer al profesor Mishani realmente por compartir desde adentro lo que se está haciendo en el Hospital Hadassah y desde su visión de lo que es el futuro, cuáles son las tendencias que vienen hacia adelante. Estamos recibiendo, profesor Mishani, estamos recibiendo mensajes en el chat que están en español, pero que hablan de una excelente presentación, que agradecen esta excelente presentación que hizo el profesor Mishani. Es realmente un lujo poder tener este conocimiento a nuestro alcance, pero bueno, este es solamente en principio. Creo que los próximos pasos van a ser poder armar forums de intercambio en los que se pueda más, de forma más práctica, compartir el conocimiento y generar conocimiento juntos. En el chat pueden ver, para los que no están inscritos todavía a la Red de Salud Hadassah en América Latina, pueden ver el link que les permite conectarse con, si lo ven en el chat, conectarse a la Red de Salud y de esta forma poder tener acceso a todo este tipo de eventos exclusivos que nosotros estamos promoviendo y también a las actividades posteriores y oportunidades de colaboración que se van a ir abriendo. Y bueno, con estas palabras, profesor Mishani, muchísimas gracias. Toda rabá, thank you very much. Un gusto poder haber compartido este evento contigo.
Thank you, George, and thank you everybody for your time. My pleasure.
Muy bien, nos despedimos de este evento y deseándoles a todos muchos éxitos. Se siguen llegando las gracias de Uruguay ahora, que agradecen que nos ha dado una amplia visión de la experiencia de Hadassah y que es muy importante poder compartir como centro de referencia. Y bueno, en este sentido seguiremos compartiendo, seguiremos colaborando y seguiremos de esa forma construyendo juntos un mundo más sano. Hasta la próxima.